Hello, everyone. My name is Joel Eagle. I'm a partner in Thompson Hines Environmental Group. Welcome to today's webinar, What is PFAS and Why Should I Care? I'm joined by my colleague, Bill Hubbard, a partner in Thompson Hines Product Liability and Construction Practice Groups. Before we begin, I'm going to address a few housekeeping items. First, today's program is being recorded and we will be sending a link to all attendees within 48 hours of today's presentation. This presentation is intended for the general information of individuals and organizations on matters of current interest. The thoughts and opinions being expressed today are those of the individual panel members only and do not necessarily reflect the opinions of the panel members, clients, employers, affiliates, or Thompson Hine. The content should not be taken as advice, as views expressed are for informational purposes only. If you have any questions during the webinar, feel free to use the question box located in the control panel on the right side of your screen to submit questions. We will answer questions as many as we can, both during the presentation and at the end of the webinar. And if we don't get to your questions during the webinar, we'll follow up after the program by email or phone. We will be offering CLE credit for today's webinar. Please be sure to complete the verification of attendance survey. A link to the survey is included in the agenda that can be found in the handout section of the control panel. That's located on the right-hand side of your screen. And we will also paste the link in the chat at the end of the program. We will announce the tracking code at the end of the program. In the handout panel, you can also download a copy of today's PowerPoint slides as well as bios for me and Bill. So again, thank you for your interest and let's get started. I'm Joel Eagle again. I'm a partner in the Environmental Practice Group in Cleveland. I counsel clients on a wide variety of environmental issues, and for the last several years, that has focused a large amount on PFAS in the environment and in products.
And I'm Bill Hubbard. I'm a partner in our product liability and construction group, and I focus on PFAS primarily in the toxic tort and also product liability litigation perspective. So I come at it from that angle. So today, this afternoon, we're going to spend an hour with you all, and Joel is going to cover the first part of the presentation, talking just generally about what PFAS is, the various regulatory initiatives that are going on, PFAS in the environment, and then PFAS in products, and then I'm going to talk about litigation and also strategies and best practices to talk about evolving liabilities with PFAS. But again, it's a kind of a 10,000 foot view on PFAS. So I'll turn it over to you, Joel.
Great. Yeah, so we have a lot to cover. I think we were pretty ambitious in what we're trying to cover today, but there is a lot. So the goal is to give you an overview of what's going on and hopefully some takeaways that you can think about. So key takeaways, just to get things started. I've been giving these talks for several years, and it used to be that I would say this is the tip of the iceberg in terms of PFAS and the environment and knowledge about PFAS, but over the last 3, 4, 5 years, that tip of the iceberg is certainly grown. There's so much going on in the regulatory space. There's a lot of litigation. We're learning more and more from a toxicological standpoint about what potential risks are from certain PFAS compounds. PFAS are now being regulated more and more through permits, which we're going to cover. And then a lot of you have seen over the last several years what's happening with PFAS at historical contaminated sites and investigation and remediation of PFAS at these sites. So one thing that I think is really important is, of course, stay current on the changes, and that can be difficult, but that's why you're here today. But know your jurisdiction, because there are federal requirements. There are federal regulatory and statutory requirements, but there are also guidance documents that many agencies treat largely as law, although they're not. But there are also state requirements, state cleanup investigation and cleanup requirements, state product statutes and regulations that are impacting what PFAS are allowed in products. So know your jurisdiction, know where your company operates and where you sell products if you sell products. Another thing that's really important is, from a high level, companies have to decide what type of approach they want to take to PFAS. You can be very proactive or you can be very reactive or anywhere in between. So what we recommend is to really know what your PFAS exposure might be. And we'll talk about that some more, but that's largely by understanding what your historical and current practices are. Do investigations. You can do some investigations under attorney-client privilege to protect the results of the investigation, but know what your risks are. And then public relations and risk management. So PFAS is in the news all the time. Literally every day, there are countless articles that talk about new PFAS issues. And so at some point, you have to make decisions about how to address maybe a news story that's released about you or another company in your industry, and you have to decide what to do about that. And finally, worldwide attention. I mean, this is not just a U.S. issue. In fact, Europe is proposing some regulations that would be even more stringent than in the United States. PFAS are ubiquitous. There's actually an individual who is the one who, I guess, coined the phrase ubiquitous in terms of PFAS, but you can't read an article or hear a presentation without PFAS being described as ubiquitous, because in some respects it is. You see stories like the one on the left-hand side about PFAS being found, 26 different types of PFAS being found in ice in a very remote part of Scandinavia. The center screenshot is actually an interactive map that the Environmental Working Group maintains that has each of the dots represents either known users of PFAS or suspected users or airports that used the firefighting foam that contained PFAS, landfills or other potential sources. And you can see, and you can focus in on this for very detailed where PFAS might be in the environment. And it's not just that it's in the environment, but it's very complex. When you think about site remediation in particular, some compounds are complex and stable, like PCBs, but they're not necessarily very mobile in water. You can go through the Venn diagram, but the complexity for PFAS is it hits all three of these. It's very complex, it's stable, and it's mobile in water, which makes it difficult to clean up and creates a lot of issues in terms of pinpointing who's responsible for PFAS in a particular area. PFAS in modern society, this is just letting you see some of the industries where PFAS is used. One of the key ones is the aqueous film forming foam. That's the firefighting foam that's used to fight chemical fires where water can't be used. And it's at municipal airports and private airports. And it's historically used two of the main primarily studied PFAS compounds, which are PFOS and PFOA. But I mean, you look at this list and see all of the modern products that use some type of PFAS chemical. So PFAS is ubiquitous. It's manufactured, obviously. So you have potential liability as a manufacturer of PFAS. It's manufactured for companies to use. So the companies that are manufacturing products that contain a PFAS compound have potential liability. There are also manufacturers and some that we speak with that it turns out that they have PFAS in their products, but they didn't realize it. It was either at a very, very small level or they otherwise it didn't show up on a safety data sheet, or they just didn't know from their supplier or otherwise that PFAS was in the product, and that can create liability downstream.
And I would say that's probably, in our experience, that's more common lately. We have a lot of clients who are finding that PFAS is in their product or in their raw materials, and they didn't realize it was. So we'll talk about that more later on.
Right. I talked about AFFF, not just use. So the picture on the right is showing a foam being used in an actual fire or fire training, but a lot of chemical companies and airports use PFAS in AFFF for training exercises, just making sure that the systems worked, spraying the foam on the ground and then just letting the foam that contained the PFAS dissipate and get into the environment. So when you're looking at a potential source of PFAS, you don't just ask yourself whether you had a fire, an actual fire at your location, but whether really you ever stored it at the facility at all. And then because it's so mobile, it might actually show up on your property when you have no connection to it. And so that comes up in a lot of corporate and real estate transactional settings where you might do a phase one environmental site investigation that identifies that there might be a landfill or a PFAS manufacturer or user nearby. And if you were to do a phase two subsurface investigation or not, you might have a risk that there's actually PFAS on your property anyway. And then to top all of that off, it might migrate through drinking water, through precipitation, through air deposition. There are a lot of studies that show it in rainwater and in the air, which means it can travel quite far distances without you having any control over it. Since PFAS has been in the news for a long time, and it's been in the queue for regulation for a long period of time, but over the last 3 years, the Biden administration has really put an exclamation point on PFAS for federal regulation. In Joe Biden's campaign materials, he had an environmental justice plan. That's a quote from the plan that was very specific about tackling PFAS and some of the ways they were planning on doing that if elected. And of course, what you're going to see in this presentation, if you didn't already know it, is that a lot of these campaign goals are now being implemented. And that's being implemented through EPA's PFAS strategic roadmap. The EPA strategic roadmap is from 2021. Before that, EPA had a PFAS action plan. And so the roadmap is the what's in place now. And you'll see a lot of the initiatives that US EPA is doing is directly from the roadmap. Finally, every couple of years, every 3 or 4 years, EPA comes out with new national enforcement and compliance initiatives. And currently there is a proposed initiatives for 2024 to 2027. And not surprisingly, PFAS, addressing PFAS contamination and holding those responsible parties that allowed it to be introduced into the environment responsible for the contamination. The PFAS strategic roadmap, as I mentioned, started in 2021. In November of 2022, EPA put out a report of 1 year of progress. And you know, these are just some of the main aspects that are being addressed right now. The ones that are highlighted are ones that are some of the more important ones that we're going to talk about today. But every one of these subcategories is important. It's part of the whole of government approach that EPA is implementing to try to address PFAS in many areas of regulation. So let's start with EPA's proposal to set two PFAS compounds as CERCLA hazardous substances. In one of our intro slides, you saw that not all PFAS are the same. So one of the mistakes that people often make are to call PFAS, you know, EPA is regulating PFAS, or PFAS are going to be listed as hazardous substances, when in reality, PFAS are a category of chemicals, man-made chemicals that span anywhere from, depending on who you talk to or what you read, 5,000 to 10,000 different PFAS per and polyfluoroalkyl substances that make up the PFAS family. So EPA is currently proposing to set PFAS, two PFAS compounds, PFOS and PFOA, as CERCLA hazardous substances. And that rulemaking is ongoing right now. The public comment period has ended. I checked this morning, there were over 64,000 public comments issued, which, I mean, that's a lot, it's certainly a lot for any regulation. Environmental regulations do get a lot of comments, but 64,000 is a lot for the agency to get through, but they have to get through them, and they are planning on issuing a final rule. Their goal is to issue that final rule by the end of the year or earlier. And in the meantime, EPA issued an advance notice of proposed rulemaking, and the comment period for that is ongoing and ends on June 12th. And that advance notice is to list additional CERCLA, PFAS is CERCLA hazardous substances, and you can see the list right there. And then you see the asterisk at the bottom. EPA is also asking for comments on whether the precursors to PFOA and PFOS and these listed seven compounds as CERCLA hazardous substances too. You know, what this really means is that for the two that are proposed right now and that for these additional PFAS compounds, the potential liability under CERCLA, the federal Superfund law, could really expand a lot. Right now, if you get a request from EPA to do sampling or cleanup for PFAS, you know, some parties are taking the position that they're not regulated under CERCLA yet, and therefore you don't have to do anything. Some regions are accepting that argument and others are not. But when PFOS and PFOA are finalized, and assuming they are, it's going to open the door for all sorts of CERCLA liability, which I'll talk about a little bit more in just a moment.
Yeah, and I'd say if you don't take anything away from this presentation other than what Joel mentioned, that PFAS is thousands and thousands of different types of substances. So it's very important that you drill down and concentrate on what actual PFAS chemical is being regulated and what you might either have at your site or what might be in your product.
All right, PFAS in drinking water. So another one of the key initiatives that's been talked about at the federal level for many years since the PFAS Action Plan was first issued and even before that was setting primary drinking water standards, maximum contaminant level standards for certain of the PFAS chemicals. In 2016, EPA issued non-binding levels called health advisory levels for PFOS and PFOA, and they were set at 70 parts per trillion. So when you think about parts, how much EPA is regulating, in the environmental world, we talk about parts per million, we talk about parts per billion, but we seldom talk about parts per trillion. But PFOA and PFOS are thought about at a much more stringent level. So 70 parts per trillion is quite low. In 2022, EPA issued updated health advisory levels for PFOS and PFOA. So they went from 70 parts per trillion to 4 and 20 parts per quadrillion, which are just remarkably low levels. So they're well below the levels that any lab can test at, which raised some concerns about what the purpose of having a level that low would be. But EPA also added 4 other health advisory levels for other PFAS compounds that you can see on the slide. And then most recently in April of 2023, EPA finally issued a draft proposed rule for setting binding maximum contaminant drinking water levels for all these compounds. And you can see 4 parts per trillion for PFOS and PFOA, just the lowest levels a lab can detect at, extremely low, going to create a lot of concern for the regulated community, drinking water, water suppliers, and ultimately consumers. That public comment period is ongoing right now. It ends May 30th. And again, I checked this morning, 47,000 comments for a rule that still has a couple of weeks. So expect similar 60-some thousand comments for EPA to get through. But again, the goal here is for EPA to finalize the rule either early by the end of this year or early next year. We can talk a lot about what the impacts are going to be, but one obvious impact might be litigation that is filed once these final rules are implemented, because at that point they are final and subject to Administrative Procedure Act litigation. And I mean, there's just a lot of industry groups and individual parties who have comments that, if not addressed, might lead to challenges under the Administrative Procedures Act. A lot of money is getting thrown around here for PFAS. The bipartisan infrastructure law has $2 billion to address emerging contaminants, including PFAS. There are other emerging contaminants, but PFAS is the primary one that's being discussed right now and money being doled out. So earlier this year, EPA issued grants under the Emerging Contaminants in Small and Disadvantaged Communities grant program to, I believe, every state. Seeing some of the numbers, they ranged for each state from 5 to 10 million up to upwards of, I've seen 80 to 150 million for some states. And the focus here is on the water suppliers in small, rural, and disadvantaged communities. I mentioned PFAS and Superfund. So there are a lot of impacts that might come out of EPA listing, finally listing PFOS and PFOA and potentially other PFAS compounds as hazardous substances. For many years now, many EPA regions are asking Superfund sites to address PFAS either at a known site where PFAS was used or disposed of, or at any Superfund site. EPA has been asking parties, either individuals or PRP groups, to sample and just see what the lay of the land is with PFAS. So that's been ongoing. It's going to be tremendously more important once the final rule is promulgated. EPA is also using its five-year review process under Superfund to identify sites where it wants to see PFAS sampling. And you know, other tools EPA has, 104E requests under CERCLA are information requests that allow EPA to ask you questions about your historical practices, for example. So you might already have seen, or you will be seeing, information requests for EPA to try to get its arms around what PFAS exists at particular sites. And then even sites that are very mature, that have existing consent decrees, administrative orders, unilateral orders, administrative orders, even sites that are delisted, there's a risk here that EPA is going to ask for very mature sites or delisted sites to sample for PFAS because they hadn't been sampled before. There are tools that parties can use to fingerprint for PFAS because of the ubiquitous nature of PFAS. The question becomes, if you find PFAS at your site, is it because it originated at your site, or did it come from somewhere else, some anthropogenic source nearby? And so fingerprinting, there are fingerprinting tools that are available. And I'm working with some clients right now on fingerprinting and identifying that there are different types of PFAS, even for PFOA or PFOS or particular PFAS compounds, that there are different chemical signatures that might indicate that your PFAS is different than somebody else's PFAS that was sourced from somewhere else. What will that lead to? It'll lead to a lot of finger pointing because the liability, the risk of liability or actual liability is so great that if you have a PFAS site, it's very likely that you're going to want to look at other sources and figure and spend the resources to figure out if there are other parties nearby that you can bring to the table or that might be responsible for all the contamination at your site. So a lot of finger pointing and likely litigation to come out of that. Real quickly, there's rumblings, and this has been going on for a couple of years now, but current rumblings that EPA will also propose rules to list PFOS and PFOA under RCRA, which would trigger not just, in addition to the CERCLA liability, corrective action requirements under RCRA. So in this approach that EPA is taking to use all of its tools available to it, you are seeing EPA thinking about every media, every environmental statute, regulation that it can to try to pull in parties to address PFAS. Just recently, EPA held a couple of information sessions where it announced recently, but it discussed the fact that it's going to be issuing an enforcement discretion policy under CERCLA, where EPA is going to focus its attention on the manufacturers and other parties that are directly responsible for the releases, but it also is going to carve out enforcement discretion for parties that either aren't responsible, or you can see the second bullet, that have a community bent, community waters, utilities, public landfills, PFAS shows up in biosolids from wastewater treatment plants that ends up being used on farms for fertilizer. So the unintended consequence for farmers, they're considering not taking action against the farmers where PFAS is used, and then state and tribal and municipal airports, but not private airports. You know, important to think about here that this is just CERCLA. Other statutes, other federal environmental statutes are not going to be subject to this enforcement discretion policy, and that EPA will always consider its ability to address PFAS when there's an imminent and substantial endangerment situation, regardless of how it views this policy. I mean, one of the issues with the policy is it's not a law or a regulation, it's not binding, it's just a policy. And so a lot of the comments that we heard during the listening sessions were that these are great in terms of principles that EPA is thinking about, but unless you put this into a binding regulation, the risk remains. And the risk is not just theoretical for enforcement under other non-CERCLA statutes. EPA was very, very deliberate last week or 2 weeks ago in publicizing its first ever federal Clean Water Act enforcement action that addressed PFAS from discharge under an authorized NPDES discharge permit. So there were PFAS limits set for this facility, and there actually aren't that many facilities in the country that currently have PFAS in their NPDES permits, but this one did because it manufactured PFAS, certain PFAS, and EPA took action against the company for alleged violations of the permit for exceeding permit limits. And the quote at the bottom says it all. Administrator Regan has directed staff to use every enforcement tool at its disposal to compel manufacturers of PFAS to address the contamination. So this is the first one. It's certainly not going to be the last one, whether under a NPDES permit or other Clean Water Act authority, EPA is going to use every opportunity it can to address PFAS in the environment. So I've talked a lot about PFAS in the environment, but many states are now regulating PFAS in products. And Bill's going to talk more about a lot of the litigation that's already been initiated or settled regarding this, but 11 states to date have laws on the books. Some are already effective, like New York and California, that prohibit or limit PFAS in products, specifically in food packaging. Each state is different and their requirements are different, but all 11 states have a couple of similarities. They all mention that the law applies to intentionally added PFAS as opposed to unintentionally added PFAS. It's broadly defined. PFAS is broadly defined as one fully fluorinated carbon atom. That fluorinated carbon atom is what makes PFAS so useful, but also so difficult to remediate. It's the strongest bond in nature, and so one fluorinated carbon atom is enough to trigger the impact of the laws. Some of the laws apply only to plant-based packaging, while others, or fiber-based packaging, and others apply to any packaging. And California is unique in that it not only has the intentionally added qualifier, but it has a qualifier that talks about whether the PFAS has a functional purpose or the levels are at or above 100 parts per million. So something that we're seeing more and more from our clients are they are getting requests from customers to certify that their products do not contain PFAS. And Bill's going to talk more about what some of the risks are in signing a certification. I mean, you have to look at not just the certification itself, but if you have supply agreements, whether you're indemnifying parties for statements that you're making. But this is, it's becoming a much more common request, especially as these state laws are being passed more frequently. And then I'll just end with the discussion of Europe. So it's not just in the United States. PFAS is used all over the world, and ECHA, the European Chemical Agency, has a proposed rule right now that would restrict PFAS over 10,000 different PFAS compounds, again, with one or more fluorinated carbon atoms in products. And this could have a ripple effect across the world for parties that might use PFAS in any of their chemical or product manufacturing. But the comment period for that rule is in effect right now. It'll go through September, and then if passed, the goal is to have the ban in effect, enforced by 2025 and actually effective in 2026 or 2027. So what do you do with all this information? Know your business. One of the first steps would be to understand historically and currently what PFAS you might have used, either manufacturing of the PFAS or the manufacturing of a product that contained PFAS. You can call it a PFAS audit or a PFAS risk mitigation plan. You can call it different things, but understanding your business, because without knowing, you hear all about PFAS in all these different contexts, but without knowing what your risk profile is, you're kind of shooting in the dark. So it's important to know what you're dealing with. And if you are dealing with PFAS, a lot of our clients are considering reformulations. It's certainly easier said than done to just reformulate a product. But as these regulations become more prominent, lawsuits continue, publicity gets worse. There is a push to in the R&D space to reformulate products and just get PFAS out of products completely. If you have a FFF currently with PFOS or PFOA or any other PFAS, it's important to secure the storage tanks against releases or any other PFAS that you might have on your facilities, secure against releases so you don't create additional liability. We'd have a whole conversation about how to address PFAS in corporate and real estate transactions, but in the past, most purchase and sales agreements, for example, didn't cover PFAS because they weren't defined as CERCLA hazardous substances or hazardous materials, and however most purchase agreements were defined, but that has all changed, and PFAS is being addressed very specifically in many agreements that we see. Can you get insurance for PFAS? Did you have insurance for historical PFAS? Again, another very big topic that we could have another webinar on, and maybe we will, but some insurance providers, everyone knows about PFAS in the insurance industry. Some insurance purveyors are considering PFAS coverage in limited circumstances. You know, they don't, insurance companies, not surprisingly, don't want to take on really unknown extreme liability. So there's a lot that goes into the process before an insurer is willing to take on PFAS. But we have heard that some providers are giving PLL or commercial liability policies that cover PFAS. And then historically, before the pollution exclusion, there are arguments that your historical policies might have covered PFAS. So and I have seen at least one instance where that historical policy was triggered and coverage was accepted for PFAS. And then to remediate or not to remediate, this really comes down to what you know about your site, what EPA or a state environmental agency is requiring, and then addressing it. And addressing it is very difficult. It's very expensive. But there are a growing number of consultants who have expertise in PFAS remediation, and we work with several of them. So with that, I think that's it, Bill. I'm going to turn it over to you.
Thanks, Joel. So I'm going to touch on litigation. And the joke on mass tort has always been, what's the next asbestos? And people thought maybe mold litigation was, or maybe silica or BPA or phthalates. Mm-hmm. It's becoming pretty apparent that PFAS is the next asbestos in with respect to litigation. All litigation is focused on the pathway to human exposure, which it's either through the environment, typically through groundwater or air dispersion or through consumer products. And so all the litigation is centered on limiting that exposure through treatment of groundwater or air contamination or getting it out of products, which we'll kind of touch on those. So you can see this is the chart, the typical causes of action in a lot of litigation. The chart on the right is from last year, from 2022, and it was kind of a projection of what the litigation is. You can see in 2020, it really skyrocketed. The assumption was that it would kind of flatten out in 2022. You can see down in the District Court for South Carolina, there's about 2,400 lawsuits. That's because that's where the AFFF, the firefighter foam, that's where that MDL is headquartered. So a lot of those claims wind up down there. Again, this is just the federal court claims. This is that same chart from this year. You can see in 2002, it was projected that it was going to level off. It hasn't. It actually increased. There's now 4,300 cases down in the AFFF MDL down in South Carolina. So it doesn't seem to be slowing down too much, although the filings down there have slowed down a little bit recently, but there's still lots of litigation going on, both with the MDL, which is mass district litigation for the AFFF cases, or other PFAS cases. The big PFAS case that kind of started it all was the subject of the movie Dark Waters. It was in the 1980s where DuPont used a byproduct of PFOA to make Teflon. And again, as Joel explained, what's so great about these PFAS chemicals is the fluorinated carbon atoms, which is very, very hard to break. And because of that, they are great for Teflon, right? Because it has a bond that oils and food can't break through and can't stick. The same reason why they're good at other coatings.
Even at very high temperatures.
Right. The same reason why they're very, very good at clothing, right? Stain-proof clothing, waterproof suede shoes. All of that is because of these fluorinated carbon atoms that have a very, very tight bond that keep them from, or that allow them to shed water, allow them to be stain resistant. That's why they are in all sorts of carpet. A lot of carpet manufacturers are defendants, but that's also why they stick around, because they are very, very hard to break down, as opposed to like diesel breaks down very easily. Other products break down very easily. These do not, and so these stick around. But what happened in that DuPont case is there's a class action that was settled, and part of the class action was the agreement to provide medical monitoring and fund a science panel, which was the C8 panel, which was a group of epidemiologists who looked at the science. And in all these toxic tort cases, there's two things you've got to prove. You have to prove general causation, which is generally this product or this chemical can cause this injury. And then you've got to prove specific causation that for this specific plaintiff, this chemical, the person was exposed to it at a significant amount that actually specifically caused their injury. It caused their heart disease, or it caused their cancer, or whatever it is. The science panel took care of that first issue, which was general causation. And it found that PFOA could cause high cholesterol, thyroid disease, kidney and testicular cancer, pregnancy-induced hypertension, and ulcerative colitis. And then because of that, then there were approximately 3,500 personal injury claims brought for people who had those injuries, and those resulted in significant settlements. So there's been a couple big dollar settlements early on, which obviously have gotten people's attention. That then spurs shareholder class actions. But again, most of the early cases were were groundwater cases where the manufacturers of PFAS were sued because the PFAS was getting into the groundwater, and the various municipalities and groundwater or water companies had to treat that. And the way you treat for PFAS is you have these enormous tanks of granulated activated carbon, and the water flows through these tanks and is more or less adheres, the PFAS adheres to the granulated activated carbon, and then you've got clean water comes out the other side. Typically those go through two tanks, and these are absolutely enormous tanks that have to be constructed, have to be built, and then the activated carbon has to be changed out regularly.
And depending on the concentrations, more right. regularly, and activated carbon is very expensive. And since COVID, right. carbon is even more expensive. So it's the amount of cost associated with cleaning right. up is tremendous.
And there are companies that are looking at being able to recycle that that carbon. But it's the same for municipalities. You either have these big, enormous tanks that are millions of dollars to install, and you've got the cost of the carbon, or people's individual wells, they have smaller tanks, like the size of like a soft water tank or something like that. They've got two of those with activated carbon that their water goes through before they then go to the water softener. But those have to be installed at a cost of a couple thousand dollars, and the carbon has to be run through it.
The carbon being the expensive part of that makes it difficult for smaller municipalities, small water purveyors,
right.
to pay for this. So
that's, right, and maintain it, right? That's the big thing. And there's, even though these have been around for a while, I mean, there's still Weldon, North Carolina, just filed a claim last week. The Maine, state of Maine, their attorney general, North Carolina's attorney general, they've all recently filed claims against manufacturers for the cost of having to deal with it. There's also unique situations like this. This was brought by the Middlesex Water Company. There's contamination of their water supply by 3M. And so they've got to treat their water. Middlesex has a claim against 3M, but then Middlesex customers brought a class action against Middlesex for the additional cost on their water bill for having to have the water treated. Ironic, and then Middlesex passed that on to 3M. Ironically, they're just increasing their own cost because the plaintiffs, their water bill has increased, but now their water bill is increased again because Middlesex has to defend against those claims. But then after it got past the manufacturers of PFAS, it got down to the users of PFAS, whether it's for shoes or for clothing or for carpets. And as Joel said, you have some sites where tanks of PFAS leaked or it got into the groundwater, and now adjacent communities have to treat that groundwater, or that there's a potential exposure to those claims. They've had, some of those manufacturers have had some success. Just last week, there's a case in New Hampshire against a plastic manufacturer that used PFOA in its manufacturing process. And there they were, the Supreme Court of New Hampshire affirmed summary judgment on behalf of the manufacturer who got the medical monitoring claim dismissed, because it found that that the fact that there's a risk of a disease under New Hampshire law is not an injury. So just the simple fact that there might be a higher risk of a disease does not amount to an injury under a negligence theory. And so they were able to get summary judgment on those medical monitoring claims, which is important. The risk issue is important. You're on the regulatory side, which is focused on risk, the risk of harm, and they may look at much, much lower levels of PFAS that may cause an increased risk of harm. On the litigation side, they're looking at actual injury. What amount of exposure to PFAS might actually cause this person's injury. Now we are seeing litigation across the board for all sorts of manufacturers. For example, cosmetics. It seems like every single time there is a study done on a type of product, they find PFAS in it. And then that results in an avalanche of lawsuits. Joel and I were talking about this earlier, is that there's different ways to measure PFAS, and one is a total organic fluoride process, right?
Mm-hmm.
That it doesn't actually measure the PFAS. It's an easier measurement that measures the fluoride elements, and then from then it somewhat is like a precursor. You assume that it has PFAS in it. So when these studies come out, it is very important to understand the testing methodology and did they actually measure for a certain PFAS chemical, or is it some other type of test methodology that measures the total fluorine and then kind of approximates what the PFAS might be. But in any event, these types of studies where they find PFAS or report to find PFAS in a product lead to a lot of litigation. And this is really where a lot of product litigation comes from. And it's a combination of the greenwashing type claims, which you may have heard about, which is the claim that a product or a service is green. It's safe. It's safe for the environment. It's safe for human health.
It's biodegradable.
Right.
It's recyclable.
Right. And there's all sorts of, and that's what greenwashing is, a whole nother seminar of its own that we could, that some of our colleagues have done. But really it's these claims of safe and things like that the manufacturers are getting in trouble with. And like, for example, in these cosmetic ones, it's where you're saying that the product is safe, it's pure. There's a list of things that are not in the product on the website, and somehow you are implying that it is safe, but lo and behold, it has PFAS in it. So the allegation, it is not safe. And so it's a false marketing claim. Mostly these are obviously in California, just because of the jurisdiction is there is friendly to these types of claims.
And some of these claims are even being brought when the product tells you that there's a PFAS compound in it.
Right.
But.
Right. Those claims are called front label, back label. So if the front of the package implies that it is safe and that it does, you do not need, and it does not have anything bad for you in it, the consumer should not have to look at the back of the label, which actually has the ingredients, to identify that sure enough, it actually does have this product, or it does have this ingredient. And so it's kind of what is the consumer expectation? If he or she looks at the label, and if it implies that it is healthy and it's safe, it's effective, and it doesn't have the right qualifiers, then they should not have to look at the back of the label to show that the front of the label is wrong.
Well, a good example is I recently bought a nonstick pan, and the packaging said PFOS free.
Okay, great.
So I good. Brought it home, and I told my wife that it's PFOS free, but that doesn't mean it was any other
right.
free from any of the other PFAS compounds.
Right.
I know that, but other consumers might not.
Right, exactly. And so similar to food packaging, Joel touched on these, but the same thing. There are studies done finding PFAS chemicals on food packaging, again, because you want the food packaging to be grease proof, right? You don't want the oils from the food or the liquids from the food getting out of the packaging. And so they're coated with liners or with coatings that have PFAS in them because they are waterproof and they shed grease and they shed stains. And because of that, there's a study done by Consumer Reports that found, again, fluorine in the packaging, and that is a kind of a marker for PFAS, and that then resulted in a number of lawsuits just within a few years. Which Joel's example of the cookware and where we've lately been helping our clients is this PFAS-free moniker, whether it's something you want to tell your customers or something that you are asking of your raw material suppliers, or that you're being asked to make a representation of the community. For example, there's turf fields. There was in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, and this isn't necessarily litigation, but it's an issue, because in Portsmouth, New Hampshire, they had I think it was a carpeting factory that has a PFAS plume. So that was a very big issue for the community. They were installing new turf fields at their high school, and they specified that they wanted a PFAS free field. And so the architect said, fine, we'll get you a PFAS free field. And the manufacturer of the turf said, yes, we can supply a PFAS free field. They went to install it, and a citizen went and cut out a piece of the turf and had it tested, and the field gets installed. The results come back, and there is low levels of a certain PFAS chemical in it. So it wasn't necessarily PFAS free. It was free of the PFAS that are typically at issue, PFOA, and other similar PFAS chemicals, but it wasn't, quote, PFAS free. And there's a whole lot of issues in that community of what to do. And so when you're talking about either making a representation or demanding a representation from your suppliers as to PFAS free, be careful what that means. And as Joel said, there's a lot of statutes and laws coming out in various states on various products, again, including turf, where it's PFAS containing turf has been, the city of Boston says they will not install any turf fields with PFAS. California and Vermont have state laws currently going through the process of being enacted. But when you're talking about PFAS free, you need to be careful of what you say, and it's better to reference a certain standard or a testing methodology, whether it's an EPA testing methodology or an ASTM testing methodology and standard. It's clear as to what PFAS chemicals are tested and what the reporting limits are. Because as Joel said, a lot of these groundwater limits are that a lot of it, test companies can't even measure to those, right? And so you need to be very clear that it's not necessarily PFAS free. What you're saying is that it's been measured to the ASTM standard D7968, whatever standard you're using, and that tells the reader, should he or she want to look into it, what PFAS chemicals are being tested and what the testing limits are to, what the reportable limits of that testing methodology is. Or you use, the regulatory or the statutory language of that PFAS is not intentionally added. So you might have raw materials that come to you as part of your manufacturing process. You are not intentionally adding PFAS as part of your manufacturing process. Again, all of this needs to be backed up with data, and you have to have that testing methodology. You have to have the test results. You have to have all of that, so when someone comes knocking and asks for it, you have it.
But one of the unfortunate consequences of being accurate is that people ask questions. If you say, I didn't intentionally add PFAS, then didn't you just say it was PFAS free?
Right.
If you say, well, I tested it to, it's below 4 parts per trillion, then you say, well, can't you tell, is it at 3?
Right.
So you shouldn't not be accurate,
right,
but the impact of being accurate might just lead to additional questions.
Right. And similar, we've had clients who say our current version of the product is PFAS free, or is not PFAS, it's what meets the standard. Okay, well, what about your prior product, right? And we've had instances where folks go out and buy old versions online or through eBay or something of a product and have that old version tested, and that might have PFAS in it. So there's a lot of issues there.
But when you test that old product, was the PFAS in the product
right
when it was made, or did the PFAS get there? Did you spray some
right
fabric.
Right.
But, you know, waterproofing on it later.
Right. And if it was outside, was it exposed to groundwater or air dispersion from a nearby factory? There's all
sorts
of questions.
Did you wash the clothes?
Right.
In water that contains, you could go down a lot of different
right.
paths.
And we've been down those rabbit holes. And if sometimes there are articles, a lot of what's been in the news lately is an article will come out that this type of product has PFAS in it. And that's it. And then they want the reader to then infer that that's not good, right? That causes cancer, that causes other things. And so you kind of find yourself on the defensive. And so in those situations, we think there's safety in numbers. Don't go it alone. To the extent you can get your trade association to cooperate, obviously there's antitrust rules and that kind of thing, but to the extent you get your trade association to cooperate with a PR strategy or unified response to those types of broad product-wide claims, that's helpful because that way no particular manufacturer comes out ahead of things and makes itself a target. There are plenty of great resources out there. The American Chemistry Council has a great site on PFAS and it's how it's essential in modern society, and there's a lot of other resources there. But again, it's we've talked a lot with a lot of our clients about not so much the actual litigation. We have had some issues or some clients who are in litigation with PFAS, but mostly for most of our clients, it's okay, we have a PR issue, or we want to make some certification, or we want to require our suppliers to certify that is quote PFAS free. How do we go about doing that? So that's really where most of the product liability and our corporate folks are finding themselves answering those types of questions.
And you wouldn't be surprised to find out that the ACC is very interested in some of the EPA rules and questioning the regulations themselves, the levels that they're being set at. I see we're getting close to the end of the time, but I see one of the questions relates to are there health standards attributed to PFAS settled? Is it settled science? I mean, the short answer, and in the ACC will vociferously say this, and the answer is no, especially not for all the PFAS. And you know, while PFOS and PFOA have been studied more than others, and a dozen or two others have been studied to some level, you still have thousands and thousands of PFAS compounds that have not been studied. And making broad stroke determinations of health risks it can be dangerous. So the answer to the participant's question is science is the jury is still out on a lot of these compounds. The EPA is focusing a lot of its resources on toxicity studies right now, because they recognize that that's an important aspect of proposing new rules and regulating PFAS more broadly than they're doing right now.
Right, but that's one of the problems I think with people who are voluntarily getting rid of PFAS, that certain PFAS have not been studied yet. And to your point earlier, that requires you to reform. That stuff is in there for a reason,
right?
But it's requiring you to reformulate, and what's going in there instead. And so we have a great example. We have one of our experts we use a lot. She was testifying in Congress about BPA in baby bottles. And at the time she had a newborn, and someone asked her, well, just to be safer than sorry, do you use BPA-free bottles? And she said, no, I actually go out of my way. She actually imported them from Germany. She got baby bottles with BPA in them because she's studied it. She knows it's safe. And so if you take the BPA out, you're putting something else in there in its spot, which might not yet be studied. And so I think a lot of this idea of it's better to be safe than sorry, you've got to be careful with that. And you don't want to get ahead of the science, but unfortunately, I think in certain situations, the EPA or regulatory industries or the public is demanding that companies do get ahead of the science and remove PFAS from their products if they can. But just be aware that also carries its own risk.
I mean, it's really just a fever pitch, right?
Right.
We've gotten to the point where the regulations that the EPA and states are passing are in part driven by publicity that may not be backed. Right. Action needs to be taken because everybody's in an uproar. And of course, we all want to be protective of human health and the environment, but without having the science to back it up,
right?
It could be a dangerous proposition.
Well, let me interrupt. I know we're at the 3 o'clock hour. We want to make sure you get out of here on time. We'll field some more questions in a second, but the tracking code, so you get your CLE credit, is TH1876. Again, that's TH1876. And there should be a link for the verification form and for the survey. That's set. It's on there. Great. But we'll stick around for now. We've got one or two more questions we're happy to answer. We're also not offended if you have to leave, but we'll spend another minute or two to answer. But again, that tracking code is TH1876. One other question I think I saw there was, and I think it was for you, Joel, there's so many regulations at issue. How as a company do you focus on how do you cut through it all and focus on what you need to focus on?
Yeah, I mean, the daily news on PFAS is ubiquitous.
You can't say that.
You can't read a daily news article without right. something about PFAS, and it can be very difficult to monitor it all. I mean, the short answer to that is going back to my comment before, know your business. So if there's a TSCA rule that's proposed, but you have nothing to do, your products have nothing to do with TSCA, or you don't manufacture any products, then TSCA may not be where you need to focus. But if you're in the business of buying and selling real estate, you're going to want to understand things like when ASTM makes a change to their due diligence standard to mention PFAS for the first time. You need to understand what that is, or drinking water maximum contaminant levels that might impact a remediation site. So you just have to know, you can't know everything all at once, and you can't research everything all at once, but you have to prioritize based on what you know of your business,
what the highest risk is,
what your risks are, right. And then how to quantify them through current and new regulations.
Good. One of the other questions I saw there, which I think I can answer, is can we rely on raw material supplier non-use confirmation or testing? Or is testing required? I think the safest thing is to test your own product. Again, if you are relying on confirmation from raw material suppliers, again, I think the safest thing is to say, okay, give us your confirmation, and what are you confirming, right? We want the actual lab results from the lab that tested your product. And then I think it's best to have your own product tested. We've had clients where all of their raw materials, except for one, one of their minor ingredients did have some PFAS in it, because they tested that coming in, the raw materials, but then their final product did not have PFAS at the number at reporting limits, because although it was in that raw material, when it was such that raw material was such a small percentage of the final product that when they tested the final product, it was kind of washed out. It was in there, but it wasn't at a level that was reportable and that was detectable, because it was
diluted.
Yeah. It was so diluted. So I think it's, yes, you can, I think, rely on confirmation from your suppliers, but I think the best is to ultimately test your end product, because you also don't know if the manufacturing process, that things may occur during the manufacturing process. And there are, if you don't have the technical advisors on site, I'm sure most of you do have the technical folks on site for the product, there's plenty of experts who can help you out with those issues.
A plaintiff's attorney is always going to question, no matter what the data is, they're going to question it, but to be more confident in the results, using your own testing processes
right.
gives you, might give, should give you, if you're using a good consultant lab should give you better confidence.
Right. And I think the requirement as things change, unfortunately, that you things you may have tested 4 or 5 years ago or things you may test now in 4 or 5 years, as the labs get better and better and can test to a lower and lower level, you might have to find yourself redoing those types of tests and those types of certifications. So,
I think we should wrap up. We've got a couple more questions that we will follow up on, but thank you very much for joining again today. And please follow up with me or Bill if you have any questions or want to discuss PFAS more.